Alright, so now it's time to hand over to the star of the evening. Gary Trower, thank you so very much for being here and for going to all this effort to present this wonderful talk to us. So let's just give him a round of applause again.
Okay, good evening everyone. Since I was a child, I've been passionate about the Bushman, and some people think that the word Bushman is, you know, offensive, but a lot of my Bushman friends say Akaza Bushman. You know, if you go to Namibia, some people don't like use the word San, so different groups have got different names that they prefer to be called. But I just refer to them as the Bushman. So tonight I'll be talking about my experiences with the Bushman, and I guess it's been a lifelong dream and an interest since I was a child to spend time with them, you know, learn about the dance, learn about the healing. So in 2000 was the first time that I got a chance to work with communities, and basically I've been working with communities since then, firstly in Botswana and now more recently in Namibia. I don't know if anybody knows the political situation in Botswana with the Bushmen, but yeah, the government there is a bit cracking down, no more hunting allowed, we got arrested. They thought we were trying to make an expose of the Bushmen. So when I was there, we got arrested, we had a little adventure there. But after that, I just decided, you know, Botswana's become too political, you know, we're being watched now, and so we moved across to Namibia, and there is a lot more freedom. So that's where I've been working the last few years. But a lot of these pictures, as I go along, I'll just tell you whether it's from South Africa, Namibia, or Botswana. And I'll just start now with this picture up here. Okay, a lot of people don't know that the San people are actually indigenous to Southern Africa. So basically, we've had people living in Southern Africa since the Pliocene. We've got, you know, ape men, Australopithecines. We've got Homo habilis, Homo erectus, Homo heidelbergensis. So we've got various species of human ancestors in South Africa. So the ancestors of the San have been living here for millions of years. And we know that because of the fossils and because of the stone tools. I'm actually an archaeologist, also working paleontology. It's more specifically paleoanthropology, which is the study of the fossils of human ancestors. So we know that Bushman ancestors have been in Southern Africa for a very, very long time. They are the indigenous people of South Africa. But, you know, Bushmen from 50,000 years ago didn't look like Bushmen from 20,000. The Bushman race, as we know them today, actually only came into being in the last 10,000 years. There was an extinction 11,500 years ago, at the end of the Pleistocene, where many animals went extinct across the planet, and the earth became very dry. And that's actually when the San race appeared as we know them today. The San, before 10,000 years ago, were actually taller people. And then during that drying out phase of the earth, they actually became shorter people. So if you look at the bones of the San before that, they were actually taller than they are today. Okay, so basically I just wanted to introduce the San, who they are. Through genetics, there's a woman from Wits that's done a lot on the genetics. We know that the San people are one of the earliest surviving races. Every single person on the planet has San DNA in them, which means that the San are part of our ancestral group. People left Africa, there's different theories on when people left Africa, but when they left Africa, they already had that San DNA in them. So even white people, everyone across the planet has that San code, DNA, in their DNA. They're also the most genetically diverse people, and like I said, they're one of the most ancient races. So, like I said, their ancestry goes back a very, very long time, the genetics as well. Can everybody hear me without the microphone? Or should I just...
Yeah.
Is it all right?
Yeah.
Okay, now basically the San people are, you know, their skin color is generally reddish, yellowish. They also have distinct facial features, high cheekbones. They also have no ridge over here on their nose. So if you... A lot of the San nowadays are mixed with other people, but if you meet like a genetically... You know, like I say, if you meet a San that's genetically quite pure, they have a lot of very distinct facial features. So like I said, as I go through the pictures now, this is just... I used to look at a place in Botswana called Khamsi Craft, and people would rock up from, you know, from their villages and come sell craft. So
This is just showing you, you know, the traditional flywood, which is really made out of a wildebeest tail, symptoms, hemp spore, but yellow. This bag over here is made from a plant, and they actually carry about 20 ostrich eggs inside there. So when they're carrying water, that's the bag they used to transport the ostrich eggs in. So this guy just rocked up to sell, you know, he's like, this is called a dye fell, a Bushman underwear dye. If you meet like real traditional some people, they might have clothes on, but you can always see their guys sticking out from underneath because it's like their underwear. So traditional guys don't ever take that skin off, it never gets washed. Yeah. So anyway, so this guy just rocked up one day to sell some of his stuff, and some of these photographs are not mine. I found that when working with sign communities, don't work out your camera. That approach doesn't work at all. So a lot of these photos are not my photos. And people are much more relaxed when you're not taking photos. You know, I never used to have a notebook asking questions and taking pictures because that just doesn't work. So most of the time I just never took photos because you're getting a much better response, a much more genuine response from the people if they see that you're not there to, you know, study them. So this is actually taken by my old boss of a guy that rocked up there. And the fly whisk is actually is used for cleansing. It's sort of like a witch would use a broom. And you know, like if you think of Lord of the Flies, okay, the term Lord of the Flies, one of the old Bushman elders that's passed away now, he spoke of a he was one of the artists at one of the projects, and he did this painting of this really scary looking figure, and he said this is some type of a demon thing, and it actually has chopsticks and it catches flies and eats them with these chopsticks. Okay, so he did a painting of this demon thing that eats flies with chopsticks. So the fly whisk is actually used for chasing away flies, because flies you know, bring disease, death. So even like an antelope's always whisking its tail up there to get rid of the flies. So it's also a way of clearing away that energy of the flies, you know, disease, death. So that can also be used during the healing dance for cleansing. Okay, then just to show you what a more traditional sign looks like, and you can also see here, there's really no ridge on the nose here at all. It's totally flat there. You know, also the hairs very often forms like in peppercorns. You know, these people are, like I said, they're way out in the bush, they're not mixed with other people. The mistake I made was meeting sign people and then judging them by how they look. Oh, this guy's too tall, he's too black, you know, he's got Western clothes on. But then you spend time with those people and they sometimes turn out being the most powerful healers, you know. So just because they mix, it doesn't, they grew up in the bush. And so some of the guys which I judged when I met them by their looks turned out being really traditional and very powerful healers. So that was a mistake. Another time you meet sign people that look, you know, like in terms of their features, they look very, very pure. But they grew up in the town, or they grew up on a farm, and they don't really know a lot about trancing. You know, they might know about some medicinal plants. So looking at someone and saying, oh, he looks like a real bushman, is not a good way of getting to know the people, because they always surprise you. That's another typical sign elder. You can see more reddish skin color. You can see over here no ridge on the nose. This guy actually, you know, like I say, you don't find many people that look like this anymore. A lot of the Sano have, through the Botswana government, moving the people out of the bush, forcing them to settle in villages, and so you don't find a lot of traditional people anymore. But if you go way out into the bush, you find guys that are still very cute. Like this guy actually makes blankets out of jackal skins. He either uses fox or jackal, and he stitches, you know, like a whole bunch of skins, and he makes these huge double blankets for a bed. I mean, they are beautiful, and they're very, very warm. And he actually specializes in making blankets. So, I mean, he's the only out guy that I met in the whole of Botswana that knows how to make these blankets, you know. So, and that takes like, I think he sells them for about 1,000 pula. But, I mean, that's like months and months of hunting, you know, preparing the skin, stitching them. I mean, it's like really weeks and weeks of work, only for 1,000. But anyway, he's one of the elders that I met out in the bush. That's another friend of mine, Kulabar. He's passed away now. My friend Sean also knew him, but he's actually from the Cape, from the Northern Cape of South Africa, and very interesting character. this guy actually, when you're dancing, I'll get to the dancing just now, but when you're dancing, the sweat is considered very powerful, because even your endorphins are coming through your sweat. So even if someone's been at the gym or running a marathon, and then you come and hug them, you actually, that sweat gets absorbed through your skin and you start feeling like good, like from the endorphins. So this guy at a dance, sometimes people will come and, you know, take all their sweat and come and rub it on you, and you're like, I mean, it's just part of the thing, you know, you learn that, oh, like, it's like a really a blessing that someone's like giving you their energy. So when we'd dance, when he would be really all sweaty and I'd be all sweaty, and then he would come and like hug me, like trying to transfer the sweat a lot, you know. And so just to show you some ladies from Botswana, from the village of Togai, and yeah, like I say, a lot of the younger people don't dress like this anymore. They all have wigs or their hair all done up, and so now these elders still have the knowledge, but like I said, the younger people are not really so clued up on their culture, like these elders. That's just traditional, you know, back in the days, Saan women used to have ostrich eggshell beads in their hair, and they also used, you know, red ochre. It's basically like Bushman glitter in their hair to look beautiful, and so, but obviously nowadays, glass beads are very commonly used. And if you can see over here, she's got a tattoo on her face. A lot of the Saan women have tattoos on their faces, and also in the middle of their head. Sometimes it's zebra pattern, creme spork pattern. So like if they're tattooed on their legs, they'll have a whole bunch of stripes, like zebra stripes down their legs. But like it's only the elders that have these tattoos. I don't, like once in a blue moon, I would see a teenager or a younger person, so younger than 25 or 50, that would have tattoos. But nowadays, nobody gets tattooed anymore. The tattoos are, there's many, many different types of tattoos. Like you get ones that are inoculation. So for snake bites, there's a whole bunch of different ingredients you use. You know, baboon spider. I don't know if you know what a nubu slongy is. It's a legless lizard, like those skinks that crawl in the sand. They take all of these things, they dry them out, and then they cut them into you. And it's also mixed with plant ingredients, and it's actually inoculation. So if you're ever bitten by a snake, spider, scorpion, you actually inoculate against the poison because they've already cut all of those things into you. And also how the medicine works is that it prevents you from ever stepping on a snake or scorpion. So if you go and sleep anywhere in the bush, because you have that scorpion cut into you or the spider cut into you, when the spider comes crawling at night, it'll actually turn away from you. Or if you're walking on a path, you'll turn away from it. So the medicine also makes you that your paths don't cross. But if you do happen, like by any chance, to step on one or whatever, then you are inoculated. But it also works to prevent you from crossing paths. So, and also there's lion whiskers, like they'll take lion whiskers, crush them into powder. There's also specific places on your body where you get cut. So basically, very common on the joints, you know, wrists, you know, elbows, all over, like that, on the inside and the outside of your, off in the middle of your head, sometimes on the back of your neck, which is certain places where they cut you, because the Saan believe that on your body is like an alphabet. So I don't know if you've ever had like a muscle twitching, you know, you'll feel like something twitching in your leg. Like for the Saan, that's a message. So they know exactly what that message means, because where it twitches on the body, that corresponds to part of the alphabet. So it's like a symbol. So it's telling them this is going to happen, you know, it's a warning, whatever. So they also believe that on their bodies is an alphabet, and they understand. So that's why there's specific places where you get cut, which correspond to certain things in your body. So so basically the lion whiskers, for example, they'll cut you on your elbows, the back of your neck. And how that works is that you can go anywhere into the bush where there's lions and you'll be safe. But as soon as a lion comes within, say, 100 meter radius of you, this thing will just stick up. It actually like just sticks out of the skin and it'll just start itching like crazy. So it actually warns you that there's a lion very close by. So they have no problems walking in the bush where there's lions because they have this thing to warn them when there's a lion coming, and they totally believe in it. I mean, it works. Some of the stuff that I've seen and experienced is it's beyond science, you know, like you can't explain it. You know, shape shifting and all other crazy things, it's like something that we can't really understand. Maybe our minds are not used to that. I mean, I do believe some people might have experienced shape shifting or time travel or what. So I mean, these are things that the Saan know and they believe in, you know, like, I'll get to that just now, but basically, and you get guys that are cut with beeswax, and they can walk in the bush, and as soon as they're approaching a beehive, this thing starts itching, and I'll actually just go and find a beehive, and they just remove honey without being stung, no smoke, So they've been initiated to remove honey. So they just go there and remove honey. Sometimes they'll just hum a little tune or talk to the bees, but they can actually remove honey without being stung. You know? So there's different guys that are cut for different things. Okay, and a friend of mine, he actually was very aggressive when he was younger. He'd always be fighting. So his grandfather cut him exactly over here. It's like a specific plot, like place over here. And it's almost like acupuncture, you know, it's like it corresponds to meridians and stuff, but his grandfather cut him just here on the cheek and put a specific medicine in there, and that makes his right hand like a left hand. So they say he punches like a woman, so they said that he can never actually beat someone to death because now his right hand's become weak, you know. So there's all different types of tattoos that, do different things to different people. So those are just some more of the elders from the one village. And this is to show you that some of the sun has got a very reddish skin colour, especially the more traditional people in the rural areas. Okay, this study over here is called the Bakhalakhari. Bakhalakhari are the sun were first in Botswana, and then about 1,000 years ago the Bakhalakhari arrived. And they actually have quite good relationships with the sun, because they've been living in Botswana for 1,000 years. But a lot of other people look down on the Bakhalakhari and the Bushman and they say, oh, you know, you're primitive, you live out in the bushes. And so there is actually a lot of racism amongst the people. The Tswana people are quite racist towards the Sun and the Bakhalakhari. When I lived there, I was quite surprised to see that. It was a bit unpleasant. Okay, this is actually, I don't know if anyone's ever watched the movie The Great Dance. Okay, if you get a chance to watch it, it was made by two brothers from Cape Town, are friends of mine, Craig and Damien Foster. And this is actually one of the guys from the documentary. And we actually had a dance, and I wanted it to be as traditional as possible, so we actually started this fire using fire sticks. It's not actually that difficult once you know how to do it. It just works totally with the breath, but I mean, it just sometimes works on you. If you've got an off day, you can try for like ever and you won't get it. You get blisters on your hands very, very quickly. So some days you can just get it in 30 seconds, a minute, and it's going. And other times you'll be like struggling for like half an hour till your hands are like just blistered and you're like... So it's just good. It's really to do with your internal energy because you're actually just taking that breath and you're putting it into the fire. So at this particular dance, I wanted it to be like real. So I said, no matches, no life. It'd be starting the fire the traditional way. Yeah, that was just me being a little blessing. You know, these were some of the elders. Over here I was using impetu, I think mixed with sage, frankincense, a whole bunch of different incenses. But you know, just to bless the dance. Okay, the dances are really totally unpredictable. You know, the dances that I thought, I've been to maybe about 100 dances. And a lot of them were just for tourists, so the sun is just really, you know, performing, they're acting out what the healing's like, they're not, it's not real, because tourists actually get a bit freaked out when the dance becomes real. When healers go into a trance, there's actually an energy that they don't use any plants, there's no hallucinogenics, or some people will smoke, you know, smoke marijuana, smoke weed, but no one actually uses any mind-altering substances. When a sun are being initiated, it takes quite long to become a healer. I mean, I know guys that have been dancing their whole lives and they've never been into a trance. You can be called to that or you get given the gift by other healers, but it is quite difficult. You know, I spent quite a while trying to learn it, and I did started feeling crazy things. You know, electricity is the... When you know you're starting to get into that state, you feel these jolts of electricity, but you actually can see it in your mind. You'll feel it going through your arm like a big zigzag line, almost like lightning. You'll just feel it shooting, and it's like very, very powerful. It'll just go down your leg, you know. It'll only be in one limb, one leg or one arm, and you start feeling those things. And also in the rock art, you actually see paintings of men with zigzags on their legs or their arms. And also when they've asked healers to paint themselves or draw themselves, a lot of the healers will draw themselves with zigzag arms and zigzag legs. So it's like you're feeling this electricity flowing through you. And like I say, it's definitely, you can actually feel it and you actually see it in your mind. It's a bright blue light and it's traveling at speed. Now this electricity is
I mean, they're basically channeling the stuff. They call it boiling energy. And you start getting very, very hot over here. I mean, you can actually feel the heat coming from here. And you aren't allowed to drink any water, because as soon as you drink water, it cools it down. And you won't go into trance. So you just have to keep on dancing. And this heat eventually boils. It shoots up your spine. And that's actually when you enter the trance state. And only twice before I've actually entered a trance. But it's like, you know, the sun will just collapse into the sand. And but they're used to it. Like, but for me, I would, as you feel yourself falling, because even though you're totally unconscious, like something kicks in saying, oh, I'm going to like hit my head, you know, and you like wake up. So like they just have that ability to fall into the sand because they're so far gone. But I would still be like falling, and then you like wake up and you're like, oh, damn, you know, I'm like awake now. So only twice I actually got to that stage where I was like totally in like a trance, and then the falling actually woke me up. But I did start feeling a lot of the electricity and the heat. I mean, it's like an incredible heat. And when you start sweating, like when the sweat's just coming out of you, then you know that you're very close, and you'll even start like staggering, like you feel a little bit drunk. And it's not from exhaustion. You know, I always thought it's hyperventilation, exhaustion, but that's not what causes it. Like I say, some dances you rock up, there's a lot of people, everyone's like, and they like, because you know, it's a lot of energy to organize dances. Sometimes people want to get paid. Sometimes the women are like not in the mood to sing. I mean, it might be a really cold night. So, you know, we dance in winter as well. So sometimes people just aren't in the mood. And sometimes you have to really like put energy into getting it going. But sometimes you just rock up and everyone's in a good mood. Everyone's laughing. And there's a lot of people there. And you're like, wow, this is going to be amazing. And that like turns up being the shittiest dance ever. So those ones which you think are going to be like amazing turn out being really bad. And then the ones which you think are going to suck very bad into not being amazing. That was like a big lesson. So it was totally unpredictable. Now I came to one dance and there were some, the men were like so drunk, they were like falling all over the place. I mean, they couldn't even, and I just thought, you know, this is not right. You know, this is like serious. You're here to heal sick people and you're like arriving here drunk. This is not like, you're not going to go to a drunk doctor, you know, like. So I was quite annoyed when I rocked up there and I saw, okay, these guys are totally drunk. And so anyway, I thought, okay, I'll just stick it out. And so the woman was singing, oh, yeah, you know, they were all tired and you can see they weren't in the mood. And then I was like, okay, this is going downhill really fast. So then as I was about to leave, two Bushman women arrived there that I knew. So they just came to join in and they started singing. So we had two extra voices, which can make a lot of difference. And all of a sudden, it started slowly picking up. So I was actually just about to leave when these two women arrived. And I thought, okay, well, my friends have come now, I'll spend a little bit of time. And then it just started picking up. And then it just went from being like really, really bad to being really, really, really powerful. And like, what happened was when those men went into a trance, they're totally above the drunkenness. I mean, like they were like really falling over. Now they're like, they're all of a sudden in such a trance that, I mean, they are like, so focused, because you know, when I was dancing behind them, I could see the alcohol's gone now. You know, like, and you can still smell the alcohol coming out of them, but they're now like so awake and so serious. And all of a sudden, those drunk men, which I thought were like real losers, were all of a sudden really doing powerful healing and going into trance, and they were just sweating that alcohol out immediately. And that dance went from disastrous to like very, very powerful. You know, sometimes a dance will go through the night. It doesn't happen often because like, obviously people get tired. I mean, firewood, you know, if you want to have a dance through the night, you need like a big pile of firewood like this. Because not only is this fire, there's people that are taking wood and making their own little fires. Some people don't want to be by the main dance, so start their own little fire. So to have a dance going through the night, you need like, and I'm not saying little, you know, you need like tree stumps. Big, you have to actually go out and spend a few hours collecting firewood if you want to have a dance. Because you go through like a lot of wood, especially if it's in winter. I mean, it's really, really cold. But these fires become so hot, you can only stand like over there sometimes for like a few seconds before even eggs are being roasted. Because obviously the women move the circle closer to the fire, and then you've only got like a very, very small space between the woman and the fire. And then if you want to go, so generally you dance around the outside of the woman, or you can dance on the inner circle. But it's, like I say, sometimes it's like cooking in the middle there, like your legs get. Okay, this is this idea is trecha, and this is like
just when I arrived in Botswana right in the beginning. And like I say, these were like tourist like dances, I call them tourist dances, but they're really just performing, no one's going to trance. Because like I said, some people aren't used to what happens. You know, when that energy boils, the healers start screaming. I mean, even the most like experienced healers that are like, they've been doing this their whole lives, they are like screaming in pain. They're going mad, and so some tourists will be really freaked out, like, hey, what's going on now? So that's why when they're doing it for the tourists, they don't really do that, because, like I said, people aren't used to it. And also sometimes when the guys in trance, they might do something strange. They might like run off into the dark and start climbing a tree, and then like one of the people will have to pull them out of the tree because they're in trance. They're not totally, so they're like almost in a dream state, you know, but they're not 100% aware of what's going on. So, and sometimes, like, they'll climb up someone, and there'll be like an old granny sitting there singing, and one of the healers will decide, now I'm going to climb up this woman now, and try and stand on her head, and then someone will pull him off, you know. He doesn't really know what he's doing. I once saw a guy decided, now he's going to put the fire out, and he just started kicking sand, like tons of sand onto the fire, and dragged him away. So sometimes when people are in trance, they don't do scary stuff. They don't get possessed, you know, like in Zulu culture, sometimes the ancestors will come into someone and they'll start talking in a funny voice, and there's none of that. The people are totally, they might be astral traveling, but they're totally there in their bodies. They're not, there's no spirit possession, there's no you know, weird voices coming out of them. It's just them, but they're just almost in a dreamlike state, not 100% sure what's going on sometimes. Okay, this was one of my teachers over here, Val. So if a woman wants you to dance with her, or if a healer wants to teach you, then they extend the stick to you, so she'll be dancing, and she'll come hand you the stick, and then you have to dance behind her. So at this place, they used to get really annoyed when it would be tourists there, and I'd be like dancing with the bushman. They're like, please don't dance with the bushman. They want like this white guy. The tourists want to see bushman, they don't want to see a white guy dancing with the bushman. So then I had to tell my teacher, please don't give me the stick, you know, because I'm not allowed to actually dance with you guys, you know. So from then onwards, it would only be really be private dancers that I could join in, because the management of this place. But sometimes I would say, like, okay, everybody, the last song you can join in, you know, that would be my excuse to join in. So that was the only way that I could get to dance. Because obviously people are paying money for this. I mean, the people that are taking part in these dances are only getting 30 pula. This was a few years ago, each. So if it's 600 pula and there's 20 people, each person's getting 30 pula. So for hours of singing, 30 pula is not a lot of money. So, I mean, you know, people are paying money for this. You can't just take over the dance. So a lot of the times I just had to sit there a bit annoyed, not being able to dance. Okay, this is when you've been dancing for hours. You can see it makes like a beep. So that's a few hours of dancing. So in the morning when you know you've had a really powerful dance, there'll be this big ring around the fire. You know, the sun also say, when our ancestors join in the dance, there'll be a ring around the moon. So if you're having a very powerful dance down here, you'll see it up in the sky, because the ring around the moon is this ring. The ring we're making around the fire, they're now making a ring around the moon, but they're dancing around the moon. And I actually was at a very powerful dance in Botswana where we actually saw. I said, hey, check the ring around the moon. So that night, it was quite powerful. And they were like, oh, so it was so normal. Oh, no, that's normal. And they're like, so I mean, it doesn't. So that particular night, I actually saw this, they talk about the ancestors dancing around the moon. Okay, this is when Pinker was, once you start coming out of trance, you can start healing a bit. Sometimes people will actually guide you. And when you're in a deep trance, there's always someone standing next to you, because like I say, they might do crazy stuff, try and jump in the fire, try and climb on a granny. So when you're in a deep trance, there's always someone standing next to you to help you, guide you, make sure you don't, you know, do something silly. Because this is when Kirche was in trance, they just asked me to come help. I mean, I don't know what I was supposed to do. I'm like, okay. But there's a certain way you have to fold, put the guy's feet next to each other, you have to fold his hands. And so that's just the posture that you have to put the guy in when he first goes into trance. So there is the, we're just, because yeah, he's like really in deep trance now. It'll take him a few seconds or minutes to start coming out where he's in a state where he can heal. But yeah, he's like really in a deep trance. And they also said I must kick the underside of his feet. I'm not really sure. They're like, yeah, I'll kick him under his feet. It's going to help him like come a bit out of the trance. So I was just standing there smiling, saying, "Oh, they're joking, or is this like real?" So the dancers in the village were a different setting. This was not at the place where the tourists used to come. This is actually in the village. And what I found quite annoying was the local minister used to attend all of these dances, saying, "Oh, this is Satanism. You're going to burn in hell." And like, it was so annoying. So it would be nice to have a dance in the village, but you'd always have this unwelcome guest, this like minister that would be judging the people. And if any healers wanted to lay their hands on him, he was like, "No, no, it's witchcraft. You can't touch me." And so it was quite annoying having him there the whole time. Like I say, some of the healers can do really amazing things. Like I said, there are shapeshifters. Very often guys will change into lions. It's the most common animal that people shapeshift into. They can also shapeshift into elephants and numerous other animals. This is like real, as in like changing into a lion. I don't know how the people do this stuff. A guy I met, a contemporary is now Mantas. I heard of a Bushman living in the Free State. In the village of Ikomotseng. So I went there to meet this guy, and people said he had been stealing sheep for years, and the cops were never able to catch this guy. And every time the cops rock up, he's gone. Okay, so this is like everyone in the village is reporting him, he's stealing the sheep. So eventually the cops rock up there one day, and they see this old Bushman guy, he was really short, and he used to walk like this slow, and it would take him like a long time to walk a little short distance, and walking really slowly. But so people said they would see him coming down the road, you know, really slowly, and all of a sudden he'd be tapping on the shoulder. You're like, "How did he just get there?" You know, like the other like walks like this, you know. So a lot of people said he would always appear behind them and tap them on the shoulder, like they never knew how he got there. But the one time the police saw him walking down the road, and they went, so they arrived there and they come and he's gone. And there was just this rotten goat full of like maggots. So everyone in the village said, "Yeah, you see, he shapeshifted into a rotten goat and he just lay there, and the cops came and they couldn't find him, they just saw the goat." And I thought, okay, well, maybe he just was hiding in the long grass, or maybe he hid behind a bush, whatever, you know. But then another time, and this was witnessed by like a lot of people in the village, the village is very, very small. Literally from his house to the police station is like a 1 minute drive. So the police finally caught this guy. I mean, people saw him being taken, put in the back of the van, close the van, drive to the police station. They get to the police station, open the back, no person. And so just a fly flew out. Okay. So this is, I mean, a lot of people in the village tell the story over and over. I mean, you hear it, even if you go there and you ask people, I'll tell you the story about him changing into a fly. So, I mean, this is a story of a guy changing into a fly. So after the cops decide, okay, this can't be held, just like leaving, you know. But when I was in Botswana, I mean, I met a lot of shapeshifters, and most of them are healers. Like, if a guy's hungry, he'll change into a lion and go out and kill a cow and feed on the cow, you know. So, but there, you know, like there's a healer called Sitano, and he describes changing into a star. So when he's, you know, in trance, he says, I change into a star, I go visit my friends in the sky, and then I fall back to the earth and I'm a human again. So guys can also shapeshift into, like I said, not a fly or a lion, even into stars, you know. So these guys are really, and people always ask, "Oh, have you seen someone shapeshifting?" I'm like, "No, I haven't seen someone shapeshifting, but I've met so many people that have." And I've also, when I was in Botswana, there'd be a lot of write-ups in the newspaper about they shoot a lion and they track the lion and they find like a bushman with a bullet wound in him, you know. So these stories were in the newspaper, I mean, when I lived in Botswana. So there was a lot of stories like that going around. So I don't know how these guys shapeshift, but they can do really crazy things. They can also go to the fire. Some people will actually wash their face in the coals. So this is like something that you can't explain with science. We would get third-degree burns. These O's will actually, you know, bend down at the fire and scoop up, I'm talking like red-hot coals, and like wash your face, you know, like, okay, normal. Some people would actually stick the top of their head like in the coals, and they'd like rub their head in the coals for like a few seconds, and then they wouldn't be burnt or nothing, and you're like, okay, that's... So some guys would also take a single coal, and I mean, it's like you wouldn't be able to hold that for, I mean, like a second. And they'll start like bathing themselves, you know, with coal for like just a few seconds before they throw it back in the fire. And then there was also stories of people that can swallow red-hot coals. And in the Native American culture, some of those shamans would also swallow red-hot coals. But this, the one story that I heard in Botswana of a guy doing this, he actually died. So it doesn't always work, you know. But there are some guys that can actually swallow red-hot coals. Okay, basically, there's several different types of healers. There's specialists. Guys that specialize in doing tattoos, guys that specialize in laying their hands on you, channeling this boiling energy to heal. Then you get really rare doctors that are called snort doctors. They can actually suck sickness out of your nose, sneeze it out of their nose, cough it out or sneeze it out. Sort of like the green mile, you know, like they can actually pull this out of you and they'll just sneeze it out. So snort doctors, I went all over looking for these guys. There's not many people left that can still do this. So the guys that are in trance healing, there's a few people around that can do that, but people that are actually snort doctors that can suck stuff out of you, it's like supernatural, I don't even know. And sometimes they'll even like suck something out of you and they'll take an object out of their mouth and it can be like a needle or a rusty piece of metal or like a metal brooch. No, so that's witchcraft. When people put that stuff inside you, that's like really like black magic stuff. Then you can become really ill, and they'll actually suck that thing out of you, and they'll take it out of their mouth. So sometimes it'll actually be an object, not just sneezing sickness out of you. It'll actually be a physical object that they've now sucked out of you. But that's all from witchcraft. And like I said, there's not many people that can do that, but the snort doctors are very powerful in that they can actually suck stuff out of you. A lot of the times when healers come lay their hands on you, they won't actually tell you what they saw. So if the healer doesn't lay his hands on you, then that's actually a good sign, because there's nothing wrong with you. But I'd always like it when the healers would come lay their hands on me, because sometimes they also shoot things into you. So if they're training you, they're not only laying their hands on you, they're actually shooting stuff out of them into you. That's to give you power or not connect you to that person. So these threads that they shoot into you, it can be quite dangerous. So they said if a healer is going to shoot a thread into you, he won't do it unless he knows you're going to be in the village for at least another week or so. Because if you're leaving tomorrow, he shoots this thread into you, then you leave and you hit the road, and then the thread breaks, you'll become very, very ill. And only that doctor can fix you. So he won't shoot a thread into you, because he'll make sure that you're going to hang around for a few days and make sure that the thread doesn't break. And then only then can you leave, because like I say, if you leave and that thread breaks, you will become very ill. And I also want to just now, when I get to the rock art, I'll also talk about these threads. When you go astral traveling, the sun travel along these threads, and these threads can actually break. So you can be traveling way up there, you're holding on a thread. So the sun said these, like these threads moving, I don't know if they're ley lines or what they are, but they actually grab onto them and they move along these things. So the spirit actually will latch onto these things and they go traveling into the universe. And if you're out there and a thread breaks, your spirit will fall right there, like not even on Earth, somewhere in space. And then your body will just waste away because your spirit's not there anymore. So the nothing can be done. So the only the experienced healers will then follow the thread back to where it broke. So they actually follow the thread you travel on. So they can actually see where your spirit's gone. They just follow that, go and retrieve your soul and bring it back to your body. If they don't retrieve your soul, you'll die, you'll just waste away. So also these threads that you travel along can sometimes break when you're out there in space. Okay, this is they used to have the dance festival every year in Botswana. And it used to be really amazing. It was a small arena, a little fence around it. It was like very informal and like sort of rough and ready, but it was really amazing. Now they've made it all commercialized and they've got all sponsors and they built a little stadium there. And the last time I went, it just didn't have the same vibe. Now you can't even take a photograph, it's everywhere in the background. There's just these big banners advertising the cell phone networks. So it was just, it just lost its special feel. This dance here is actually, this is actually the origins of breakdancing. I'm not joking. This dance was taken from Africa to Brazil. This is where capoeira comes from. So this dance is actually exactly the same as capoeira. The dance steps you do are exactly the same. So when slaves got taken to Brazil, they took that dance with them. capoeira eventually gave rise to breakdancing. So this is actually the roots of capoeira, this dance here, and the Bushmen still do it. These guys are from a village called New Kanakas. They're absolutely amazing dancers. And they've actually just covered themselves in ochre to look more impressive for the dance. The sticks, you know, most men will dance with sticks. Sometimes guys will have two sticks, and the stories go that when you're in trance, you can actually lean on your sticks and not fall over, and I've never ever seen anyone leaning on their sticks. And the guys normally dance like just for show, they use a stick. It's not, I've never ever seen anyone ever leaning on a stick, so that's the, what they say in the rock art, men are leaning on the sticks. And you do actually find Bushman paintings of men leaning on their sticks, but no sign that I've met do that today anymore. Yeah, this is just from a dance festival showing you know, some of the different groups. This is actually a dance where women have a melon and they throw it backwards like this, and then the next woman has to run behind her and catch it. And then all the women will just go, even the old grandmothers all are part of this, they run and catch the melon, but this is only a dance for women. I actually used to live, you can't see it, but this is actually a sand dune running here. I used to live on the back of the sand dune. Now, we also decided to do like a survival course, okay, 3 days in the bush. We actually even went and chipped salt off the salt licks from for the game. So we did. So if the salt was from the salt licks, we took poikikos pots with, and we took some, you know, containers, and we had water. And the rest of the food for 3 days we got from the bush. And we literally like starved to death. I mean, seriously. Like, we did get really nice food, you know, some nuts and Bushman spinach, and there was some nice things, but it's just not enough to sustain you. Like, every day you wake up and the sun's like, you're like, have to go looking for food now, you know, like after half an hour, okay, let's go back to the camp. So because you just don't have the energy, because you're not getting enough nutrition, you know, so, and I got so sick of eating this green slime, you have to like pound these leaves and eat this like handfuls of green slimy mushrooms, like, this is so tasty. So this is my night, where so now he's playing a song for us, yeah, so it was on the survival course. Yeah, on the second last day, we actually got a baby kudu, which was such a relief, because it was just bad as that energy we needed, it was delicious. They were just cleaning Bushman spinach. You get like sour plums and like, you know, we ate all the food, like I said, really it was like starvation rations type thing. Okay, this is just a tikha. He always had a good sense of humor, like wearing, I said, okay, dress traditionally. It was, my boss said I was looking for, said, no, he wants some photos so that people look more traditional, so tikha rocks up there wearing a tie. So, this guy used to be a healer, but then that same minister from the church said, no, you know, the dance is evil. So whenever Trika would perform for tourists, and then he feels the boiling energy coming on, he just drinks water, then it like cools down that, so he doesn't go into trance anymore. So he still performs for tourists, but he doesn't go into trance. This is my other teacher over here, Kara. So basically him and that woman I showed you earlier on were my teachers when I was there. They taught me, you know, about the dances and what it means, and you know, so I'm actually thankful to them for teaching me most of the stuff I know about the dances. A few years ago, like some people from the Rainbow Mantis, can't remember, some of you might know the guys there from Joburg, they organized like a Bushman dance festival in Magaliesburg. They invited the son from Botswana to attend, and I wasn't allowed to go with, because they went in their own little van and I wasn't allowed to drive, so I decided to drive from the, I don't know, sort of the spontaneous thing, I'm going to drive to South Africa now, attend the dance festival. So anyway, I drove 1,000 km and I just rocked up there, so God, I was happy to see everyone and just surprised that I joined them. Yeah, this is just at the dance festival, this is again Kulabar and Kang Makai. Some of the guys from the Northern Cape, from the Craker family. This is one of the other guys from that, the Great Dance, Marty. Yeah, very, very funny guy. He's got a very good sense of humor. Most Saan people older than 30 don't speak English. A lot of the guys grew up on farms, so they actually speak Afrikaans, so that's how I communicate with most people. But Nati was one of the guys that spoke English extremely well, and he had just such a good sense of humor. This was also Bao, my one teacher, and this is Dada. She's passed away now. She was one of the artists working at the dance festival. So that was actually the place where I lived in Botswana, Tenkari, which means Steenbok Biltong. And we were just trying to improve the sign and make it look more just like some visible tape. I mean, going the dark tape for the cars to see it from the highway. It wasn't all serious, we also had some fun. This is when I worked for Fancy Craft. The cool thing about Fancy Craft is we got to go like really deep into the bush. So we would basically on a Monday go buy big packs of frozen meat and drive like hundreds of kilometers into the bush, because if you don't provide food at the workshops, you have a very poor turnout. So we would always come there and cook for everyone and have a turnout. So now Mickey was always causing trouble. This time we just decided to have some fun. But she actually told this woman here in the one village that I am madly in love with her and I want to like marry her, because her husband was in jail for I don't know what offense. So this woman was convinced now that from Mickey causing trouble, that's why I described with these pictures. This woman was convinced that I was in love with her, so she like comes there and says, oh, let's just go around the corner, I just want to show you something. I'm like, can't you come visit me at my house? I just want to show you what the inside of my house looks like, you know, the whole time. Like, so I was saying, like, Mickey, what have you told this woman? So anyway, it was just this crazy woman that thought I wanted to marry her, and that's just again, Marty there posing in the picture. Like I said, it was just us at our boss was away overseas, which was gone, so we decided to just dress up and have some fun there. Just again, having a bit of fun. Yeah, look, in those remote villages, you know, there's always a music clearing somewhere in a shebeen. Sometimes you'll hear a dance starting, you know, like it's pitch dark, there's no lights, and you just hear people singing, you just follow that noise. So very often I would just wander for the dance by following the noise, you know, and I just join in with the people. Yeah, this is what happens when you pay the bushman in dollars. Sorry, I love that picture, you know. This is just from the crab community when I worked in Cedarburg. This is actually where I first met my friend Sean. So these girls are grown up now, they're about 15 years old, middles and three. Okay, this was the last surviving Drakensberg sign up on Kerik Tusi. I was also spent a lot of time with him, I was initiated with him. I've been cut three different times, but he was one of the people that cut me, so because I was really wanting to get tattooed, you know. And if it doesn't happen naturally, or if it doesn't happen easily, then maybe it's a sign you shouldn't get it done. But I just decided, now I'm going to find someone that can tattoo me. And so we're on this, like, mission. And, it was a bit crazy in the end, but, I did eventually get tattooed, but it turned out being totally, it wasn't an initiation, but in a different way than I thought it would be. So the tattoos actually look like that. I've actually got some videos just now where I'm dancing with the people just after I've been tattooed. This is just when everyone decided to jump in my car. So basically I spent a lot of time with this guy. Every weekend or second weekend I'd drive up to him and stay with him in his hut. And there were thousands and thousands of bed bugs. It was like really a challenge. At night you'd just be like, oh, this is a nightmare. So I'd sleep next to my bed, like a box of matches or a lighter or a headlamp. Wake up in the night, switch it on, you know, kill all the bed bugs around me, go back to sleep, wake up again, light a match, kill all the bed bugs around me. So those were the nights spent there, and but this guy taught me a lot about what he remembers. He actually grew up in a cave. He actually watched his grandfather paint, so this is someone that actually has a direct link with the rock art. And you know, he used to speak to his ancestors, and you know, the Bushmen, like I was saying, Bushmen don't really use plants to go into a trance, but there are a lot of records. When you are being trained, like I said, it really is difficult to enter trance, to start healing, to be able to channel that boiling energy. I mean, it's not that easy. So there were a few species of plant that could be drunk. And these guys only drink this once, only once. And then that teaches you how to go into a trance. Then from then onwards, you never drink that stuff again. So it's very different there in that they, if they do drink this plant, it's only once. There's also, in some tattoos, they also will cut stuff into you that it's also hallucinogenic. But this is not common. I mean, when I was there, I asked them about the plants. They said, yes, I know of them. They will give them to me, and then I just never did. So I actually wanted to drink this stuff to try and help me learn how to do the healing. But they were a bit reluctant, so I didn't push it, you know. But there's also records in South Africa of, you know, obviously like things like scalethium. And, you know, people say that marijuana has been here for about 500 years. So there are records of someone smoking, you know, Leonoris, Leonotus, Toponanthus camphoratus, you know, Cannabis sativa, Cyanaria aspersa. So there are actually records of someone smoking various plants. I have tried the Leonoris Leonotus. It was not nice. It does give you a very mild buzz, but it's not a nice feeling. So, but some of these plants apparently have got quite a buzz to them. But like I say, a lot of the sound that I work with do not take any plants. My one teacher, Kara, he actually didn't even want people to smoke at the dance, because the healers actually use smell. It's not actually your nose, it's actually a smell coming from inside, and that's how they smell sickness. So when they're at a dance and they're in trance, they're actually just smelling for a stinking smell. And they smell, oh, there's sickness. So if they smell your body, when they go inside you, it should just smell like flesh. But then they're smelling something that's stinking, and they know that there's a cancer there, or a tumor, or a curse. And the smell actually tells them where it comes from. So, for example, the healer will get a vision of 6 months ago, you had an argument with this person, and they started swearing at you and cursing you as you're walking away. So he actually sees the curse being planted, and the smell actually tells him, and then he can actually tell you, well, 6 months ago, you met such a person, you had an argument with them, and they said that, and they actually planted this curse. And since then, it's been, you know, fish being growing, whatever. So the smell is actually what tells them. So now, like Kara, like if someone be smoking like tobacco right under his nose at a dance, because a lot of the women, you know, in between the songs, they're filling up their pipes and smoking tobacco all the time. So he didn't like them to smoke tobacco at all, because that smell would interfere with his ability to detect the sickness. So he would always request that no one must smoke while he's, you know, healing, because he can't smell the smell. Okay, just apothecary penury, sitting there one night in a hut. Okay, this is just to move on to the whole thing of sun religion. I'll leave it on. Okay. So basically, the sun have quite different religious beliefs. Okay, some sun believe in the good God lives in the east. And he brings, you know, blessings, healing, food. And then the bad God lives in the west, and he's associated with disease, death, misfortune. So some sign groups have this duality on the east and the west. Some sign also speak about evil beings that live in the west called Nini Nose. That's directly translated. Nini Nose, they call that because they don't have any knees, so they can't actually bend their legs. So these beings, when they sleep, they actually say they prop themselves in like a fork of a tree. So the Nini Nose that sleep in the west sleep in the fork of a tree. And they're not cool beings. So they're also living in the west. And so there's a lot of beliefs. Then some San believe in the Creator, who lives in the sky, the good God, and in Mother Earth. So, for example, some San, they call the good God Goha. So Goha is the name of the Creator, the God that lives in the sky. And then Kor is the name of the Earth Mother. And she also has helpers called Chana. So at a very powerful dance, I wish I had seen this myself, and maybe one day I will still see this, but this particular group, when the dance gets very powerful, then Kor will come out of the earth. And they said that she shines so bright that you can't even see the fire. So her light outshines the fire. And she has these chana that dance with her, they are all helpers. And she's only vegetarian, so she only eats bulbs and plants. So at a dance, you are not allowed to approach Kor, the Earth Mother. She may approach you, and she sometimes will touch a man on his arm to bless him with hunting. But you are not allowed to approach her and touch her. So she'll dance for a while with them, and then she disappears back into the earth. So that's unique to that group. Other San don't tell the story, but that particular group tells the story of the Earth Mother that sometimes dances with them. And then you also get some that believe also in the good God, the creator, and in the devil. So a lot of some also believe in the devil, the bad being that, you know, basically causes disease, misfortune, and but other God, other some only believe in a good God. So they don't believe in a duality. So there's a lot of variation. There's about 85 San dialects, 8 languages. A lot of the languages are extinct, especially in southern Africa. Most of the languages of people that used to live here have gone extinct. So if you've got 85 dialects, I mean, that's quite diverse. Like when I would sometimes go traveling with my friend Kumsa, he speaks Naro, we would go out into a remote village, he couldn't understand one word of what they were saying. So that language was so different from his that he couldn't even pick up, you know, maybe he only get one word, but he couldn't understand what they were saying at all. So the languages are quite different. So that's why you can understand, because there's so many groups that have been around for so long, obviously there's going to be diversity in their religious beliefs. The most difficult language is Tong. It's got 120 letters in the alphabet. So this is like, people say that you don't speak Bushman, like, no, I didn't. You know, like, I picked up a few words here and there, but it's actually really difficult. Like, Khayo, for example, is a way of greeting. Khayo actually means, are your eyes open? So instead of saying good morning, they say Khayo, like Khayo, everyone says Khayo, are your eyes open? So that's just a common greeting in Naro. And the reason why I've put this up here is to show you just some praying mantids. Okay, praying mantids can look like leaves, insects. I mean, I've seen praying mantids that look like a stone, lichen, like bird droppings, like flowers. So now, a lot of people say, oh, like it's a hottentot's foot, this is a Bushman god. You know, that's not true. This is because of mistranslation. I don't know if anyone knows about the Blake and Lloyd records. Basically, hundreds of years ago in Cape Town, a German linguist got permission to keep some San prisoners at his house. Instead of them staying at the prison, he said, okay, I want to study the San language. These people can come live with me and be my like servants. It was actually his excuse to get these people to come live with him so that he could study their language and their culture. So there were different San people there that spoke different languages, and he actually learned to speak their languages, and he recorded 12,000 pages of folklore. So that's where that's why we know there's sort of a bit of a misinterpretation of what the praying mantid is about. Now, basically, a stick insect or a praying mantis, it's like the same word in this Bushman language. So they say God is like a praying mantis and God is like a stick insect. And they say in that he can shapeshift into any shape he wants to. Because a stick insect looks like a stick or looks like a leaf. So that's what they're just basically trying to use that symbol of that insect as what God is like. God can assume any shape he wants to. He can wear any mask he wants to. And also, they describe, you know, in the early days of Cape Town, I mean, South Africans didn't really used to celebrate Halloween. It's only become, in the last 10, 20 years, people thought, hey, like, let's be like the Americans in Halloween. But no one really used to celebrate Halloween in South Africa. But in the early days of Cape Town, Halloween was celebrated. So the San that were living in Cape Town at the time, hundreds of years ago, they were saying, God is just like these kids that run around at Halloween. Everyone's got a different mask. So they're saying God can wear any mask. So that's just basically why I'm showing you these pictures of the praying mantid. They're using that to show you, like that one there's a flower. Here we've got moss. That's a flower again. Flower. Flower. Leaf. That's a moss one or lichen. Another flower one there. This one is mimicking an ant. And like I said, I've even seen ones that look like bird droppings or, you know, lichens. That one is mimicking a moth. Okay, so basically, the reason why I want to just talk about this is to show that they're saying their God is a shapeshifter. He can wear any mask. So even if you read these, the folklore from the time, they say that God can be the lice biting you on your head. He's trying to tell you something. So at that exact moment when a lice is biting you, it's actually the Creator, and he's trying to like bring something to your attention. You know. So they're saying he can be an ant hill. He can be a lice in your head. So he can be anything he wants to be. So that's just why I'm saying the praying mantis is not the like God of the Bushman. That's the total. It's basically a symbol of their concept of God. They call this god Kachan, and he's a trickster. So he's not always good. Sometimes he'll test you, he'll play tricks on you. He's also got like a naughty side to his personality. So that particular Bushman group also had a different belief in Kachan the trickster, which a lot of other some people don't believe in. If you go in the middle of Botswana and you say, like, who's the trickster? They're like, I don't know what you're talking about. So there's so much diversity in terms of the religious beliefs amongst the Sun. But most of them do believe in a creator. Like in Nauru, they call God Niribar. So Niribar is their name for creator. Also amongst the Sun in Namibia, they say when you die, now the word death is actually used also for trance. Because when you go into trance, your metabolism becomes very, very slow. You know, your breathing and your heart rate slows down. But when you're in a deep, deep trance, and sometimes people will actually start becoming cold, you know, the lips will go blue. So if the other people see that this healer is so, so far away, they can judge by his body that he's like very far away. They'll start massaging him to revive him. So they actually want to bring his spirit back in. Because it doesn't help. You know, they'll let you astral travel for a while, but the more cold you get, that means the more further you're going away from your body. So they actually start massaging to bring the spirit back in again. So they say, like, so death is also used as a symbol for trance. So they'll sometimes call trance half death. So, like, the one sign healer said, when you die. So I don't know if they specifically mean, like, as in going into trance, or like you really, like, die, as in you've lost your body now and you're in your spirit. But they say there's four paths when you die, and three of them lead to the devil and one leads to the creator. So they say you have to choose very carefully from these four paths. So I mean, some of them also believe in, you know, these paths that lead to the devil or to God. So there's a lot of diversity, and I can't sum it up as one, this is the Bushman religion or spiritual beliefs. It's very, very diverse. Some San from Angola also believe in the dragon. Actually, the dragon is very common in San beliefs. And they use the dragon for healing. And the dragon is called the god of the underworld. So they believe when you die, you go live with the dragon. So they believe that the ancestors ride on the back of the dragon. So they say the breath of the ancestors gives the dragon the power to fly. So the breath of the ancestors is actually the wind. So, I don't know if you've ever felt, sometimes if you're at a place and there's a sacred energy, you'll feel like a gentle breeze moving there. It's like only here, it's not like the wind blowing there, this breeze is only moving here. So that's actually like spirits dancing in the wind. It's not like the wind, it is actually spirits. So they say the breath of the ancestors, the wind of the ancestors gives the dragon the power to fly. So for example in Angola, when they're going to be doing healing, the healer will start calling on their ancestors, calling up the dragon, because their ancestors are living with the dragon, so they call up the dragon, and then this wind will start blowing. This stuff is real. When I lived in Botswana, I can tell you stories of the dragon energy and stuff, so I really believe in this stuff. I don't think it's like something in fairy tale books. I mean, this is like a real... So they call up the dragon, this very powerful wind, and so basically as the healers are pulling sickness, especially if it's something really bad, they're pulling it out of someone, they'll actually throw it up into the air and let the wind take it away. So they actually call on the ancestors' wind to blow this sickness, this bad thing out of the community away. So they're actually calling on the dragon to remove that sickness, that curse or whatever it is. So some people also use the dragon for healing to like remove something from the village. But that's just that's not a common thing, like it's just the people from Angola. But other San, you know, many, many San believe in the dragon, but they don't use it for healing like the guys in Angola do. Okay, this picture here is actually just showing a woman's first menstruation. This is just to help you understand the rock art just now. When a woman has her first menstruation, they build a special hut for her where she's isolated. She's not allowed to eat food with her hands. She has to eat these special like wooden chopsticks. And there's certain food she's not allowed to eat. Men aren't allowed to see her during that time, because even if she looks at men, she can make him ill. So they've got all these beliefs about, for I can't remember if it's a week or two, she has to be isolated. That's her first menstruation. And what happens is, during that time, women will dance naked. So no men are allowed at this ceremony. So I don't even know how this picture got taken, because generally, like this is something that no men are allowed to be at. Only one elder one man is allowed to attend this dance, and he has to act out the role of the Ilang bull. So these women are actually acting out the role of Ilang females, and only one man can dance with them, and he will hold the horns like an Ilang bull. So in Bushman culture, the buttocks is extremely sexual. Like, women have no problem showing their breasts, but like, the buttocks is always covered. You know, even when women sit down or bend over, whatever, they always make sure that you cannot see their buttocks. So that is something that is never ever exposed. So that's why in this dance, no men are allowed, and the women actually flash their buttocks at the girl in the hut to show her now, like, you are now ready to, you know, have sex. This is what it's all about. You can now flash your bum at a man, because this is what we do. This is just showing, this is just obviously acting this out. So during the dance, a man will just use a branch. Sometimes I'll also even use Ilang horns, but most of the times I'll just use a branch. I think this is probably just acted out for anthropologists, because some of the women have got clothing on. There's even another two guys holding horns there. Normally at the Ilang dance, there's only one very old man that's allowed to dance naked with the woman. Now, why I've shown that is because if you look at the rock art, this image has been interpreted as, if you look at this Ilang, which is actually, the Ilang's tail always hangs between her legs to cover up her, you know, vagina, basically. So the tail is hanging down. So, like, this image is supposed to mean it's exactly the same as the image of the Ilang dance. When a woman gets initiated, you know, when she has her first menstruation, it's showing that she's now ready to have sex, and this is supposed to mean, by actually lifting your tail and flashing to the male Ilang, saying, I'm ready to receive you. So they've actually made a link between this and the Ilang dance and initiation. And I think we'll just look at that and say, it's an Ilang scratching its mouth and it's wagging its tail. But if you understand the deeper meaning of initiation, it could actually be depicting exactly what is depicted in the Ilang dance. There's also rock art paintings of naked women flashing their buttocks at a girl isolated in the hut. So we also have other paintings depicting that, but this is supposed to actually be representing that. Okay, also I was talking about dragons. The Fan also believe in mermaids. There's really beautiful paintings. I didn't have them, unfortunately, but I searched on the internet and I couldn't find them. But a lot of the problem with rock art is, you know, a lot of the people from Vitz, all of this is, oh, it's a shapeshifted shaman. You know, when you're in trance, you shapeshift into a fish. And so, I mean, okay, there is shapeshifting going on, I don't doubt that. But the Sun also speak about all the spirit beings that live out there. And they believe totally in mermaids. Even in Zulu culture, they believe in mermaids. So, in Zulu, a mermaid is Inkosazana. So, even in the Drakensberg, you get a river called the Inkosazana River. These things live in the rivers. I mean, I actually know a guy that was taken into the river, and these mermaids are totally real. I don't even doubt that they exist. Some people think, oh, mermaids, dragons, shape-shifting, time travel. I mean, this stuff is totally real. Like I say, I experienced it, and some people might not believe it, but these are real beings. That's another painting of a mermaid. Unfortunately, it's very low quality. But the mermaids can actually capture children and take them into the river. So if you want to retrieve your kids, you actually have to sprinkle buku on the water and talk to the mermaids nicely, and they might release your child. Also, if the mermaids also lure men into the river to have intercourse with them. I was told this by some Gorma that the mermaids don't have mermen, they only have mermaids. So they actually lure men into the river to have intercourse with them. And they can drown you or they can let you go afterwards. But basically, they always say to you, do you eat meat or fish? That's like the riddle. And you just say, no, I don't eat either, because they're half meat, half fish. So you just say, no, I only eat plants. So if you want to survive being put into the river by a mermaid, just get the riddle right. And also another guy told me, if you see a mermaid, don't make eye contact. He said they actually like mesmerize you with their beauty and then drag you in with their eyes. There's also other crazy images like this, which could also be water spirits, and we're not sure what they are. They could represent a whole bunch of meanings. Some rock art, we don't actually know what it means. So this one here, people have said, okay, maybe they just shapeshifted into some animal, maybe they're water spirits. But that image here, I don't actually have a good explanation for. Some of you may have seen this image before. This is the oldest rock art, the oldest art ever found. This is from Glombor Shelter, and it's been dated to 77,000 years old. And it's a clear crosshatch design. This is definitely art. Some could say it's a symbol, but this shows you that already 77,000 years ago, people had the idea of conveying an image, a symbol, an artwork. And this is just part of, you know, modern way of thinking. Humans have been around for about 200,000 years, Homo sapiens, but it's only in the last approximately 70 to 80,000 years ago that you get like, it's called modern human behavior, complex cognition, that people started thinking like us. Now, judging by the tools they made, the artworks they did, certain rituals that we find as archaeologists in caves, we can already see that by 75,000 years ago, people were already making beads. People are already doing artworks, they're doing engravings. So this is just part of, I was just on the thing about art, and I thought I'd just show you some of the oldest artworks. This one's from Namibia. This has been dated to 26,000 years old from Apollo 11 cave. And it's supposed to be a half man, half feline. So they say that these are supposed to be feet. It's not very clear, but it does sort of look like feet there at the bottom, to use imagination. But that's also quite an old artwork. It's the oldest painted artwork, not engraved. Sorry, that one's out of place. I'm not sure why that's there. Okay, this image here, a lot of rock art has people with men with lines through their penis. It's a very common thing. There you can see it there. This guy's got one here. This is one of the most elaborate ones. This one's got like, he's got like a real strange piercing there with a little hook thing going up. That's just another one of the same image. And these guys as well. There's another one there. Okay. Basically, the signs say when you shoot an animal, your spirits become joined. So it's my arrow going into the animal, our spirits are now one. So what happens is, if I urinate, the animal's going to urinate. So what that means is, basically, when an animal urinates, the body's actually processing the poison and it's leaving the body. So you don't want the animal to urinate. So they actually mix things into the poison, which prevent the animal from urinating, and also they themselves will not urinate, because then the animal will do the same thing. Also, another thing is when you're going out hunting, you're not supposed to have intercourse the day before, because they say the lion will eat you, because you've lost so much of your like vital force, you're actually very weak. The lion goes for the weakest person. So, and a whole group of hunters, rather than at 6 the night before, will get attacked by the lion. So they say that that could mean don't urinate after you've shot an animal. It could mean don't have sex when you're going hunting, but no one really knows what that means. The Bushmen didn't have piercings in their penis, so we know that it's not piercings. We think it's just basically a symbol. They're just depicting a rainmaking scene. Animals, these are rain spirits. These are real beings. There's different types. But basically, that's just showing them using, it's actually describing the story of shamans together will go into a trance, they'll go traveling in the spirit world and capture a rain animal. So that's actually a picture of them luring a rain animal in the spirit world. Okay, I'm running out of time, but that's just to show where you get engravings and paintings and where they overlap, but they're very widespread. The sign used to live in the whole of Southern Africa. Up here, the word twa. The twa was used for like short people. So up here, some of the people that are up here are actually coming from parts of Angola, actually come out of the Congo. So they're actually pygmy-like people. The pygmies in the Bushman are actually quite closely related. But all short people were called twa. So a lot of places, when the first black people arrived in Southern Africa, they would just call all these people twa. But twa doesn't always mean Bushman. But like, you get the abatwa, in Zulu. And that's just a group of women. You can often see the age of women, the older women have drooping breasts, the young girls are often depicted with very firm breasts. This is just to show you the vandalism. People scratch their names. I've found places where people have actually chipped out rock art, they sell it on eBay. Some people are really dodgy, but there is some of the sites unfortunately are vandalized. That's just a beautiful painting showing women there with their bags. That's just an elephant, maybe that's just a little antelope. Okay, this is from the Brandberg. You see these guys have got elaborate hairdresses on. That could just be a stick of some sort or one. this looks like a giraffe, but a lot of these dragon creatures I was talking about have the head of an antelope, the head of a giraffe, the head of a horse. So we've seen many, many different types of these dragons painted, and they very often have the head of some animal. This, you can see how it fades into the rock. You know, there's no body really depicted there. I mean, so maybe if you were on some unaltering substance, you would see how the, you know, I could just imagine if you were on DMT or something, you'd be able to see that thing coming out of the rock. Okay, there's also felines. This is a rock outside I found called the name of Kamagu. There's just some old woman that each one's got three medicine bags with tassels, and if you can see the tassels there. This pose of the woman in the front, the healers very often stand like that with their arms. Even when they're dancing, their arms will be out like that. So that could just be showing that this woman's actually healed by her pose that she uses with her arms. This is from an idea to Google the best. So these are just called monochrome, done in one color. Then you get like polychrome, which is done in, you know, many colors. That's just a site from, that's the Della Yorfo Swano. Just the rhino, you can see it's coming out of the rock as well. Often they come out of cracks, you know, like only half the body might be depicted. Well, these are just, I'm not actually going to talk about that now. There's also a painting of a ship. These are from the seabed. That's just to show. Now, these would often be interpreted as, you know, shape-shifted shamans, but a lot of the signs speak about the people of the early race. So they say in the beginning of time, humans were half animal, half human. So half animal, half human, which some people say are therianthropes, but there is actually a lot of recorded stories of these half human, half animals, which are actually called the people of the early race. So these actually, you could say, okay, that's two shape-shifted women, or those are people of the early race, you know. Okay, this is just to show you a dragon's head here. You can actually see it's looking straight out of the rock. It's got these tusks. Looks almost like a warthog type head. There it is again in different colors. And these are just some shaman happy people. Okay, this is a dragon up here. This is actually its tail, and here's its head there. There's just some people close by. That's just showing the tail part coming out. I actually have to end off now. That's just the dragon over there. And you can actually see people riding, even that, the way these guys from Angola described their ancestors right on the back of the dragon. Over there you can see a whole bunch of ancestral beings on the back of the dragon. And there you can actually see their head looks very much like the other head I just showed you. There's tusks coming out here and over there. And there's actually like, it's blowing something out of its nose. You see something coming out of its nose. Okay, that's about it. This, I actually have a video here I can show you a clip of, but I don't know if there's even time for that, so.
I think what we'll do is let's let Gary have a little bit of a break. We'll hand over to Penny so Penny can explain to you a bit about the medicine that you have been given as an incredible gift from EthnoTrader. And then we will go to a question and answer session. And those of you that want to stay for the question and answer session are more than welcome, and maybe Gary can show his clip then. And everyone else, if you don't want to stay for the question and answer session, you're welcome to go downstairs and start placing your orders for some really delicious food. But our kitchen will be open for a while still, I believe. Is Gabby here? I think she's already downstairs preparing. All right, so Penny, can we hand over to you? And what we'll do is we'll give both our speakers a huge round of applause at the end. In the meantime, over to Penny to talk to you about the gift in your possession.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I feel much more comfortable with Arthur, if that's okay. Sorry, I'm just going to take this off. It's more comfortable. Well, hello again, everybody. So nice to see so many people here and to watch the group grow. I'm very, very excited about being here this evening and delighted that I can just mention the Skeletium products I have. Gary has been very educational and entertaining, so I'd rather have the focus on his talk and just give you very briefly the facts about Skeletium. Skeletium has been used traditionally for, there we go, just open up that image, that's fine. Has been used for centuries. This is the fresh plant. And it's been used for centuries by the very southern African Hottentot people who used it. And it was used prior to hunting especially, but for various other things. And prior to hunting, because what it would do, if you were thirsty, it would take away your thirst. If you were hungry, it would take away your hunger. And it would give you energy. And you would feel relaxed at the same time. And in a good mood, uplifted, euphoric. So what an ideal medicine for that. And then you can imagine the applications. We refer to it as Bushman's ecstasy. It's also referred to as plant Prozac or natural Prozac. And then traditionally the names Kana, Kokhut, and Kana with a C, Kana with a K, and also Kana. And Kana is also, by some of the very Southern African Bushmen, it was the name for Ierland. Ierland is one of the animals that most often represents the spirit, the interaction with the spirit world, as I understand it. And it's quite interesting that the plant would be called Kana as well as, you know, the spirit animal. So I found that quite an interesting link. The different forms of medicine, if Scelitium tortuosum is used fresh, like this, it can be given, the juice can be given to babies with colic, a little bit of juice. It is also one of the most effective preventions and treatments for malaria. Once they try and process it and extract this, it no longer works. So, and it has to be used fresh for that. In the dried fermented form, it was used called kokhut because once it had been fermented, which incidentally one of the traditional ways was to take it, dry it out, spit in the bag of leather bag, buried for a year, and then you come back and you chew it. So we don't ferment it like that anymore. We use nice sort of laboratory-made enzymes, and the fermentation process these days is not quite so, what would you say, un-Western friendly, because nobody really wants to think that they're eating somebody's spit in the bag. So the dried forms can be used for smoking. A lot of traditional use was also used as a snuff, where almost a gram of the dried powder would actually be used as a snuff. So it was used for smoking, as a snuff, also chewed in the fermented form. Now, unfortunately, my order didn't arrive in time with my fermented Scelitium. But what I have brought with to show you are a few of the other products that we have. The fermented Scelitium powder. If you go to Dischem and you ask for Scelitium or you buy Scelitium in capsules, this is pretty much what you're going to get. It's just the natural fermented plant ground to a powder. Nothing extracted, nothing removed. It's actually a whole food. And why we sell it like this is because there's so many different applications. In tiny little doses, a pinch of this at night time will just help you sleep, relax you, calm you down. A teaspoon, if you're battling to lose weight, a teaspoon an hour before breakfast and half a teaspoon before lunch reduces appetite, reduces cravings, gives you energy, and helps you get through the day. If you're just battling with energy but you don't need to lose weight, best to take half a teaspoon about an hour after a meal so that you're at least still eating properly. But it will still give you the energy, you'll still be relaxed, and it'll help you focus. Then we have the 40 times extracts, which are a lot more intense. Now you see there are two different stickers. This one over here is, we call it Kaboom, and this one is Golden Glow. The difference between the two, and we love taking these to parties with us, as a healthy alternative to a lot of the street drugs. It gives you energy, but if you use it when you haven't had enough sleep, it's not going to keep you awake. In fact, you'll probably just go to sleep right in the spot. So it naturally gives you energy. It puts a smile on your face and a bounce in your step. This one is quite energizing indeed, whereas this one tends to be sort of more sit-down, euphoric, like a euphoric feeling running through your body, a sensational, what would you call it, experience? I suppose, yes. So those are just the two 40 times extract, very concentrated, and they don't last long. If anybody would like to try these afterwards, it's about a 40-minute sensation, so please do come and have a little test downstairs after. if you'd like. And then we have on the Leonotus leonoris petals, a 15 times extract?
Yeah.
15 times extract laid on the Leonotus petals. And for those people who do smoke, this is a lovely admixture for smoking. And it one of the legal highs, very euphoric, very uplifting, and it works very nicely with the Leonotus petals. Smoking the whole Leonotus is also apparently possible, but I don't know what this is like. I have been told it's a bit like smoking car tires, so I've never smoked car tires personally, but you can imagine that can't be good. And then, did everybody get one of these? Yes, good, okay. If you haven't had it already, it's a little snack pack developed by a guy in Cape Town. And what they've put in is a selenium extract, probably about 15 times, with honey, which seems to give it legs, and then a little bit of alcohol to preserve. So when you have the pack, the soft side down, and then the hard side up, you see there's a thin little cut in it over there, or like a little thinner line. Snap it open and stick your mouth over it straight away, and then suck the honey out, because if you don't get your mouth to it soon, the honey runs all over the place. The effects that you can expect, within 5 minutes of taking it, you'll feel a bit of a warmth running through your body. And then just a gentle upliftment, a bit of a smile on your face, a bounce in your step. In conclusion, Craig, my partner, won't you stand up so everybody can see you, Craig? We've been running Ethno Trader, well, he's been running it for 5 years, and I joined him about 2.5 years ago in Ethno Trader. And when we first got these, we didn't really know what they were because there was a confusion in the order. So I phoned my supplier and I said to him, what is this stuff? And he said, look, it's honey scalenium. Just snap it open and suck the honey out and try it. So I said, okay. And he knew that we were familiar with the honey. And Craig is generally speaking grumpy. He's grumpy. Anyway, so that morning we had it, and then he did all the normal things he does every day. He saw some clients, he did this, watched around the garden, extracted some plants, made some tinctures, and he did all his usual stuff. And he said to me that evening, he says, I've had such a wonderful day, a big smile from ear to ear, and I looked at him and I said, I had nothing to do with the honey. And he said, oh yeah, and now when we don't have the honey, I can see it sort of gradually over the days, and there was honey today, I said, better have one. And look at him, he's been smiling all day. Thank you all so much. Please, if you'd like to be on the Ethnotrader database, if you're not, I'll set up the computer downstairs and take your details so that we can send you newsletters and share any information we have. Okay, and you're welcome to come and ask Craig and myself questions as well.
Thank you so much, Penny. So yes, please go downstairs and have a look at Ethnotrader's incredible wares. Very interesting stuff, and very knowledgeable. Two very knowledgeable people that you can speak to. Now, just before we conclude and go into the Q&A session, I would like to announce the next topic for our Plant People Talk on the 23rd of September. We are going to be dealing with dreams and dream herbs. So specifically the herbs that enable you to dream. We will be looking at how they can enhance your dreams, the different types of dreams, because these different plants have different effects and can give you different dreams. We're going to be looking at traditional African Sangoma herbs, dream herbs, as well as some Amazonian plants. And obviously we will have them available afterwards for sale as well. So it's a really great topic, and what is really exciting is at the end of the session, we are going to have a panel of dream interpreters, expert dream interpreters. So bring us your dreams. I sound like the Sandman. Bring us your dreams and let's interpret them for you. So I think it's going to be a really fabulous topic. Bring your friends. The only consideration that I have is that we forgot that the 24th is a public holiday. So I have you all on my mailing list, and you're all, you are also welcome to join our Facebook group where you can see the confirmation of the date. So at this point, it is the 23rd, but we will obviously confirm that with you because we just worry that the public holiday may interfere with that. But yes, a very exciting topic. I'd like us to give Gary and Penny a very warm hand of applause and thank them. Thank you so much for your incredible gift to us tonight. Now, just before we go into Q&A, one last very important announcement. The winner of the lucky draw, do you want to know who it is? Now, I'm not seeing any reaction there. No interest? The really incredible giveaway tonight, and thank you to Jane and Penny for that. Now, what we've done is each and every one of you was given a number. We numbered the list and then we used a Google random number generator to select the winner. And the winner is Ursula. Ursula. Do we have Ursula in the room? Okay, so is she coming back?
She had to go.
She had to go. Okay. You are friends with Ursula. Okay, can we give you the gift on her behalf? Okay, please, would you like to come up and accept, it's a voucher and a chocolate for Ursula. It's a very special chocolate, full of superfoods, very high vibrational foods, and please do speak to Jane. It's probably the best chocolate I've ever tasted in my life, and it energizes you. So instead of having those horrible side effects, this is food, medicine for the body, and what better form to take it? All right. Guys, thank you so much. Gary, if I could ask you to come forward again. Oh, and sorry, another thing for Ursula, we have a little bit of skeleton, if you wouldn't mind coming to fetch that afterwards. We just didn't have it on us now. All right, so Gary and Penny are going to come to the front. If anyone would like to go ahead, if you don't want to stay for the Q&A, you're more than welcome. Please go order some food, but we don't have to spend too long on the Q&A. You can also interact with our speakers afterwards. But let's move into the Q&A session. So please just raise your hand if you'd like to tell me who you have a question for, and I will direct the question to our speakers. Any questions after our brilliant talk? Yes, thank you.
How often have you been cut?
Three times, yeah. The first time was with my Kirik, and then, the first time was with the healer from the Northern Cape, but we didn't have a proper blade. So, because you actually have to cut really deep, and then for 3 days you can't wash it, or else you'll wash it out. So that time, it didn't cut very deep, and then it didn't actually seal, because the skin has to actually grow over the medicine, so you can't actually see from the first cut, only the second and third cuts actually left scars, you know. And I wanted to get all the cuts, all the tattoos, but after the third one, I decided I'd had enough, because it was quite stressful. Now the whole, I had to go for hepatitis and HIV tests and everything, because after I got the tattoos, I started getting all these symptoms, you know. So I thought I'd maybe got hepatitis or something, so that was a bit stressful. But it was all part of the initiation, you know. But the third time was, on the top of my arms was the last time, and then I decided, you know, it's a bit finished now.
Yes,
I just wanted to ask, the translate that they entered into, is that, would that be considered a form of like higher consciousness or like an altered state of consciousness? Because you said that that it's not any kind of channeling, whereas your Zulu Sangomas and them, they will actually exit and their ancestors will come in and heal that way. So is that a version of their higher selves, if I could say it like that? Or?
It's basically like a form of lucid dreaming. So they're actually semi-awake in that dream. Like I said, when they're in the deep trance, they can't really heal, but they slowly start coming out of it. And they might be guided towards someone, to a patient. But then when they're in the lighter stages of trance, they'll actually walk around and they'll just be smelling and fighting that sickness, you know, and being the healing. But for me it was, I would just call it a lucid dream state. But also, when they're in that state, they'll see their ancestors. So like their grandfather might come and talk to them, give them advice, you know, refer them to a patient, help them do healing, tell them what plants to give that person. So a lot of people believe that the sign don't believe in their ancestors or work with their ancestors, but they all believe, you know, they can even say, my grandfather appeared as a dove. Like the one guy said there was this dove hanging around his door and he kept like this little pigeon and it was like irritating him. It was actually a little dove. He like chased it away, and then he said that night his grandfather came and said like, that was me visiting you, why did you chase me away? You know, so they do believe in their ancestors and work with their ancestors, and very often the ancestors will come to the trance and be there with them. But some of the ancestors are not cool, you know, like for example, if your grandmother crosses over, then she will want to take like a favorite grandchild with her. because she just doesn't want to be alone in the spirit world, then she'll actually latch onto that child and start leeching all the child's energy, and the child will start becoming really sick, and then she'll actually take the child into the spirit world. So the healer will actually see the grandmother that's, you know, crossed over, hanging onto that child and just pulling all her energy. And then you'll actually have to chase that grandmother away. You know? So some of the ancestors don't leave happy. Some of them, they leave and they actually miss being there, or they want to take a child with them or something like that. But they do work with their ancestors a lot.
Yeah,
no
question for you.
You spoke about the name of the god is Nariba. You then spoke a lot about the dragon, but what is the name of the dragon?
They did tell me a name in Nara, what it was. It was like some... You know, because even though when I was there, the minister had learned to speak several sign languages, because he would go and preach in the different villages, and he had never heard that word before. So then when I asked the sign, what do you call this snake that moves in the wind? And then they said the word for it, you know, and it's not a commonly used word. No one really speaks about it anymore, but each language has got a different name. And I think the people from Angola call it Chikundukundu, the dragon that moves with the wind, Chikundukundu, yeah.
Any other questions?
The three medicine bags, what did they contain?
Well, most women will have, you know, there's different size bags. Some bags are really huge, like a woman will keep, say, spare clothes in there or a pair of panties or something. So some bags have got big stuff in, but generally the smaller bags are, they can be medicines. The sun also had their own perfumes that they have different powdered roots and things, buku and various things that they're powdered themselves with. So some bags have got medicine in, some have got like cosmetic stuff in, and other stuff or just personal. So like those three ones there, I assume they would be for, but sometimes you'll get medicine men that are depicted with several bags on them, you know. So I don't know what the bags, what medicines are in there, but they generally have different bags for different things. Like I say, cosmetic and medicinal things are kept in separate bags. You know.
There was another question over here, yes.
Yes, I wanted to ask the different groups that you worked with, when they were discussing or you were talking about going into trance, did you talk about those geometric images that you often see in the rock engravings, which has been associated by the archaeologists? Did they see any of those?
Yeah, look, unfortunately I ran out of time because I was still getting to those geometrics, and I also actually had some video footage. They never really mentioned geometrics, you know. I think that the geometrics, which people are saying ectoptic phenomena, I think that they could be, you know, from like if it's the same patterns you'd see like say on DMT or like sometimes on mushrooms. So I think that some of those patterns are actually geometrics that are from taking something, you know. But none of the sound that I spoke to described seeing, you know, they only described seeing the zigzag lines, these lines that they travel on, which are like lines of, I don't know if they're ley lines or what they are, but they didn't actually specifically say they saw no, you know, this pattern or that or whatever. I never heard any of those things, you know, of actually seeing entoptic phenomena. And a lot of the things which are published, I never encountered them. You know, like people say when you go into trance, the healers bleed from the nose. I never saw anyone ever bleeding from the nose. You know, you can, like I said, the spirit doctors can sneeze sickness out of them. So some of the rock art which people are saying they're bleeding from the nose might actually be them sneezing sickness out. But a lot of the stuff which is, like I said, published, I never actually found it, you know.
Okay, another question,
Rinda?
Yeah. Yes. The mermaids, are they healers in themselves, or when they take somebody, do they actually teach them, impart their knowledge to the person? Yeah.
Well, the stories that I heard was that they can keep a person as a servant, but very often they will train you. I met a woman from Zimbabwe who said she was taken as a baby, and then like when she was like 4 or 5 years old, she just appeared in the village and she was dressed in white, and like she'd been missing for years. And they said now she'd been living in the river with these beings, and she was trained by them, and she used to use mirrors for divining, you know. So, but she told me as a child she lived in the river with these beings. So you can actually be trained by them, and then they'll eventually let you go out again. But sometimes they'll just keep you as like a... You know, the sign have told me that the dragon sometimes will keep a person alive as a servant. You can't escape. The dragon will just keep you as a servant. And you have to like work for the dragon, you know? So they can actually keep real people alive. I don't know how they do it, but they can actually keep them.
Another question from this side, any questions? Yes.
Just one last one, it's about the scalutium. Where do you get your scalutium from? I hear that there's various grades of scalutium.
Definitely, yes. There are two sources that we source from. Both of them are farmed. One, I work with a company in Cape Town that does all the extracts and things. But theirs is a farmed, I would lie to you if I told you what the name of the farm was that they used. And the other farm where a lot of our stuff is bought from is Namibia, which has probably got the highest alkaloid content of any of the natural fermented scalutium that I've seen. That's Fredolis, yeah, in Namibia. And they also do their own extracts, but just for ease of transport and no borders and whatever, I'd rather work with a Cape Town company, even though the quality from the Namibian farm is really good.
All right, shall we have one last question? Yes, Jenny.
You said it's fermented.
Yes.
How do you do that?
With an enzyme fermentation.
Yes,
yeah. So they would take it, one of the fermentation processes was to spit into the dried leaf and then tie it up in the leather pouch and bury it for a year. And it would be not the bacteria, but the enzymes from the malt that would ferment it. So, and I'm not sure if there was any kind of, you know, requirement like brush your teeth first or clean your mouth with salt or whatever. I don't know if there's anything like that before that, but I do know that was one of the traditional ways of fermenting. There were ways of speeding it up as well. So quite often they would harvest the scalutium and then tie it in a pouch and then bury it by the fire so that the heat from the fire would dry it off in the sand as well. So there were many different methods of actually getting it to a point of ingestion, but it has to be fermented in order for the four main alkaloids to be activated.
So do you buy fermented?
Yes. Yeah. Okay.
Just one quick question to Gary. When Gary was talking about the trance, I don't know if you talked about how important it is that the women clap and sing, and if they can't do it in unity, the men won't transcend. I just wanted to bring that up.
Yeah. I was I didn't get to that part. Basically, when I was talking about some dancers, you know, I always thought it was hyperventilation and, you know, all of that stuff that actually sends you into a trance. But it's actually there's power in the songs. It's the only way I can explain it. When the women are in the village, because I mean, obviously, if you think about it, you're living in the village, like you've got this irritating neighbor, but it's like cabin fever, you can't escape. You're living in that same village. So, not all the women in the village get on, you know, there's social tension. So when you have a dance, all the women that are sitting there, some might be annoyed with each other because, you know, that woman was flirting with my husband, or she borrowed some sugar and she never returned it. So whenever there's a dance, there's tension amongst the women. And if those women don't resolve that tension, they don't forgive each other, no one will go to trance. So they can sing for hours and nothing happens. There's no healing going on. It's only when the women, like, just forgive each other and they let go of all that energy, and then all of a sudden when they start synchronizing, there's no more, everyone's just forgiven everyone now, and there's just, then all of a sudden immediately it starts rising, all the women synchronize and it just gets more and more powerful, and it's actually coming from the song, and like you can really feel it in you when the women are singing and they're synchronizing. You actually feel the power rising in you, so you can actually feel the effect inside yourself when the women synchronize. So some dancers, you rock up there, they can sing for 2 hours, nothing's going on, no one's going to trance. Other dancers, after 5 minutes, the men are collapsing in trance because the women are already not angry with each other. They're arriving there in a good mood, no one's pissed off. It only takes them 5 minutes to synchronize and the men are already like falling into trance. So that actually showed me that it's all about the women synchronizing. It's all about the power in the songs, and there can't be a power in the song if the women are have social tensions, if they haven't forgiven each other. And that's really what made me realize it's not the exertion or the hyperventilation, it's actually the power that knocks you out. You know, when that power rises, and like I say, you can actually feel it. You can dance the whole night, and there can be a lot of people there, and it's like 4 a.m. when it's freezing, and you've got like 2 women sitting there and 1 guy dancing with you. Then all of a sudden, that power comes, and it rises, and it gets so powerful. The dance was more powerful at 4 a.m. with those 2 women than it was when there were 20 women singing. So also when it peaks, you never know when it's going to peak, and it lasts for like seconds, but you can actually feel it in you. It becomes like so powerful. And some dances it never happens, and at a really powerful dance it can happen twice in one night, but a lot of the times it never ever peaks. And even if you're like absolutely exhausted, when it peaks like that, like everybody will just get up. It's amazing. And even people who are half asleep or people that have been watching the whole night, even they will all of a sudden stand up. And even people opposite, you get a lot of spectators there that just watch the elves and all this old-fashioned nonsense. They just watch these old people. And they just sit there for hours. But at that moment when it peaks, every single person, even the children, teenagers, everyone gets up. And you'll have like everyone dancing at once. And it's like so powerful because everyone just gets drawn in. It's like a magnetism. They were spectators the whole night. When it happens like that, it draws everyone in. You know, even those that were like laughing at you and pointing at you, even they will join in and dance. And at the end, everyone just bursts out laughing at the end of the song because they're just laughing at themselves. Like, we've been sitting here the whole night and just like, hey, now let me join in. So people, but that's that power. Like, it really like draws you in. Even the young people that are not really interested, they even will get drawn in. You know, so it's really powerful when it happens.
All right. Okay, guys, I think we'll end the Q&A session here. I think we're going to need to ask Gary back again, judging by the incredible knowledge and the stories he has to tell. And I know that, Gary, you can also tell us something about Zulu shamanism. So this sounds like we have got a sequel talk coming up soon, because I don't know about you, but I can't do enough of this. It's just so brilliant and a really fascinating evening. So what I think we'll do, let's those of you that would like to go downstairs and have something to eat, I encourage you to do so, because we don't want to keep the kitchen up all night. but they've got some really fantastic food. But yeah, let's hang around. Gary, if you would like to stay in the room, maybe show some videos to those people that are interested. And just in conclusion, it's been so wonderful having you all here. Thank you so much for joining us. And I really hope to see you at our next talk. And let's just give one final round of applause. Cool. Thank you, guys.
Samatane, on ordina kono dema, odon nebe mfemo, odon na kojela ngono, fila no bonle samatane. Don't let